I've been gone the last week or so, and it's always interesting trying to pick up sermons online and see what you got as the main intent, because it's not quite like being here in person. And if I understand it, we started out about talking about eating steaks, and then we moved into eating ice cream bars last week. So I think I'm right on par for today. If we're moving from the main course to dessert, we haven't talked about, drinks, and we haven't talked about after-dinner meals and all sorts of other things like that. And for those of you that know me, you know that I'm a bit of a foodie, somebody who really likes to eat food. My weight would tell you that. And anybody who's been over to my house would know that I make a big deal out of eating food. When you're over, we certainly try to make a big deal out of it, and lots of interesting ingredients and things like that. Yeah, that's kind of on the opposite end. We think about savoring God's love, and I think of savoring food. And that's exactly the opposite oftentimes that we do as a Christian. You know, we have this fast food mentality when it comes to Christianity. You know, you think of the McDonald's Happy Meal, I don't see what's so happy about it. You know, in terms of culinary arts and things like that, the Happy Meal is like on the opposite extreme. You know, and Maybe in that same vein as White Castle. Has anybody been to a White Castle? You know, they have these little bitty burgers, right? They have what's called the slider craving case. And for not very much money, you can get 30 sliders. You know, and if it's called a slider, I'm not sure that really fits the definition of great gastronomic food. Wendy's claims that they make quality fast food the way that you want. By definition, you don't get fast food the way you want it. You know, you think outside the box, or maybe as Taco Bell would say, think outside the bun. And for $2, you get a Taco Bell meal, you get a burrito, Doritos, a drink, and even a free horoscope this day and age, believe it or not. Their slogan is, eat well and prosper. I'm not kidding. That's the way Christianity oftentimes is to us when we think of how we savor God's love. So often we're just moving so quickly, we miss it. And God does provide the substance of life. It's just oftentimes that we don't pick up on it. There was a gentleman, his name is Ricardo, and he was skiing, jet skiing, down in Chicago, out in Lake Michigan. And he was motoring around for quite some time and then ran out of gas about 500 yards off of shore. Well, 2 days later, the Coast Guard found him way offshore. See, he had coasted some long distance off. He was just sitting there waiting for us, is what the Coast Guard said when they questioned him. And what was even more surprising is that Ricardo was absolutely dehydrated. You see, he didn't realize that Lake Michigan was full of fresh water. So he didn't drink any of it. He sat there for 2 days out in the beating sun, just roasting to death, afraid to drink what was right around him. And that's exactly what happens to us as Christians. So often we go through life so fast, we are surrounded by the grace of God, and we can't even scoop up a little drink because we're too worried, too busy in life, whatever it happens to be, but we just miss the grace of God that's sitting right there. You know, I think that's what God wants is for us to get our attention. God provides the substance of life. He provides eternal living water through the Scriptures. It's the stuff that we need to keep us from suffering spiritual dehydration. So rather than sitting on our jet ski kind of floating along aimlessly in life, God is asking us this morning to kind of scoop up some of that spiritually refreshing water, take it in, and savor God's love. If I look at our text this morning, we're going to start off in 2 Corinthians 2, 14-ish, and I'll kind of move into our passages here in a minute. Well, let me read this real quick, and we'll open in prayer. 2 Corinthians 2, 14. Knowing that he who has raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and brings us into his presence. It's that very presence of Jesus Christ that is available to all of us who will call upon the Lord Jesus Christ as our God and Savior. And because of that, we have eternal life that's available to us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord and Savior, we are thankful that you have provided living water, and it is abundant, and it is around us, Lord. It revives us. It keeps us moving. It has us to be spiritually refreshed, Lord, and renewed. We ask that you would Fill us today, Lord, with the Spirit. Guide the conversation this morning, Lord. Encourage us. Open our ears and open our minds. And we just pray, Lord, as we would for a meal, that our conversation, just like eating a meal, would be nutritious and good for us, Lord, and building us up and edifying us and spurring us on towards greater works, Lord. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. So who's in control? God is. Will everything work out in life? We ask these big questions. Well, Jesus Christ leads us into a triumphal procession in life. He's parading us through life and answering those big questions that are there. Why am I here? Where am I going? And we've talked in the past about how we can participate with God in His holy plans to move the gospel, not only in our own lives, but in the lives of those that are right around us. And today, we have an opportunity to learn how to savor God's love and be renewed day by day in the plan and the purposes of Jesus Christ. In your outline, you should have them, hopefully. You'll see in point one is where we're going to start off this morning. We're going to be talking about how savoring God's love in renewal is accomplished by being strengthened in the faith. And we're going to start off here by talking about 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. Let me give you a little bit of context about what's going on here. In Corinth, the believers, originally when Paul was first there, they were very united in purpose. They were all energetic and moving forward. And then the trials of life started to creep in. There were some false teachers, and there were other things that were going on that were just undermining the whole church and spiritual maturity. And then what happened is Paul wrote a letter, and then he wrote a second letter. And during the second letter, he started to highlight, how do you actually move through that? And he highlighted one critical, important thing. That is our dependence on Jesus Christ. And I think we all understand that at an abstract level, that we need to be dependent on Jesus Christ. But so often, just like eating food, we eat so fast. And we don't take the time to just truly sit and savor that love relationship that we have with Jesus Christ and really ingest what it is that He's trying to teach us. You see, we all have a gospel ministry to progress the gospel and move it in our lives and move it in the lives of other people that are around us. And we need to be encouraging one another to do that. And that's where we're going to pick up this morning in 2 Corinthians. And we're going to start in chapter 4, verse 16. And we're just going to just look at the first few words here. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16. So we do not lose heart. You see, Paul starts right off in this section talking about not losing heart. He understands that in all the turmoil and everything that's going on, it's very easy to lose heart. You see, Paul had been expanding the gospel and moving it going throughout all of the first century church area. And as he was doing that, he was undergoing all kinds of sufferings and dangers. And so were the churches that he was part of and that he participated with. It's easy to lose heart. In fact, the Greek word here for losing heart literally means to give into the bad. How often in life do we look at things and we actually just give into the bad? The bad things of life, we give into it and we just let it go over. We actually surrender to those negative things that are in life. And the connotation here in this word is it's actually a cowardly surrender. Because if we understand the majesty of Jesus Christ, if we understand the magnificence of God, and we don't stick close to God's plans and purposes, it's like cowering away. And the calling this morning is that we would stick to the plan of God. You know, the troubles of life creep in. Maybe there are financial difficulties. It's hard to pay the rent or to get money for the car, or sickness comes in, or the kids, they just don't get it, or the grades in school just aren't working out. Whatever it happens to be, those troubles of life, they come in. And Paul has a very important urging here. Don't lose heart. Don't let the trials of life overtake you. You see, Paul had a calling as an apostle, as we have a calling as Christians, which is to understand the plan and purposes of Jesus Christ and work that faith out, however God has called us. And because God is calling us, He's calling us into a holy responsibility that we are not to give up. Just like the apostle Paul had a holy calling to take the gospel across the first century world, so we have a calling not to give up on Jesus Christ in our lives. We are not to abandon our calling. Instead, we're to be strengthened. This is exactly the opposite of losing heart. So But Paul responds to these continual attacks that he sees over and over and over again in his life. In fact, he was beaten and persecuted on a regular basis, and so are we in our trials and tribulations of life, where we just feel beaten down on a regular basis. And Paul didn't think that his task of ministering was so noble that he could give up, right? Sometimes we think that maybe our calling in life is so important that when the trials of life come in, that our life is so important that we could just kind of give up on where the difficulties are. And that's not at all what Paul's saying. In fact, what he's pointing at is where the difficulties are, that is a specific point and intention where God is having you focus so that through the power of Jesus Christ, you can rely on his strength to get you through that trouble. We are called in God to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we do that when every trial comes into our life, we proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ in the manner in which we take it, because we are strengthened in Jesus Christ. Just that very first part of this verse, so we. This isn't something that was just for the Apostle Paul. We includes each one of us individually. We are called to not lose heart. When you're sitting there and you're facing life's biggest difficulties, the challenges of life, what do? Reflect back on these kind of passages. We are called to not lose heart. Those of us involved in this work, we need to read and understand the signs. Now, in about a half a week or so, my family and I, we're going to go to Yellowstone Park. I guess it's, what is it, out in Wyoming area. And as we're reading up on this, they have these signs, and I think we've all seen them, at least in cartoons, do not feed the bears, right? Everybody's seen this. Don't feed the bears. Yet every year, the rangers are picking up dead bears. Well, why is that? You see, the bears normally go feed, and they find food themselves, I'm sure, killing dead animals and eating berries and fish and whatever else that they're doing. But what happens is they're given handouts from humans. And as humans give handouts, what happens? The bear forgets how to hunt and how to go after those things that they have been given a responsibility in their life to forage for their own food. This is very much like our lives, right? So often, right, we have been given a commission from God to go out and forge a life as a Christian, to take care and nurture, to grow up together in the fear and admonition of the Lord. That's the same way like a bear would go out and forage and bring in nutrition. But what happens? Satan does the same kind of junk like humans do to the bears, right? He hands them junk food. And rather than feasting on live meat, what are they doing? They're eating rubbish. And then they find their lives scouring about in a junk pile, trying to make a meal out of junk. Satan's so cruel that at the most inopportune times, he takes the food away. It's just like if we went and started feeding the bears on our camping trip and then we left, right? And then at the end of the season, right, there's no campers in Yellowstone, or not very many of them, when you start getting to October, November, December. Right when the bear needs to learn how to forage and be foraging and gathering up food and building up those body supplies for winter, the campers aren't there to provide the handouts. And that is the same thing that happens when Satan takes those little nuggets of life that seem so good. You know, maybe it's some free money. Maybe it's an easy job. Right? Maybe it's a free car. Maybe it was an easy class in school. There could be lots of things that you've been given in life that you just take for granted. And those are the things that at the most inopportune times, when the winter of your life is coming, that Satan will yank away, and you won't have the dependence on Christ because you won't have been building up your strength and learning how to be matured in him. Your whole world gets turned upside down, and right there, you are at the point where you have taken a cheap trick and have substituted that for the strength that is offered up in Jesus Christ. The implication is that we can be renewed. As we are strengthened in Jesus Christ, we can be renewed in essence, in our very person, by being strengthened in faith through Jesus Christ, if we'll just be dependent on him and learn to take our strength from Jesus Christ rather than some fake handout. And point two in your outline, to do this, you got to let the old self kind of start falling away and fading away. Looking back at that verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16. So we do not lose heart. Though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. our outer nature is wasting away or perishing. Well, this is kind of like decaying. Believe it or not, as I get older, I feel like I'm decaying. And I no doubt have had tooth decay at some point in time. Other people, Dave, you've never had a cavity, have you? Not in years. Your kids haven't had cavities. Have you guys had cavities? Nothing. Can you believe this? Just amazing. Anyways, I've got tons of cavities, and these guys are like maniacs brushing their teeth or whatever it is that they're doing. You get tons of cavities. Okay, so not everybody's perfect relative to tooth hygiene or whatever it is. But the point is, we all get decay, whether it's in our teeth, or I'll tell you what, as I get a little bit older, my knees. Yesterday I was working on the camper, my back, right? I am getting older, and I'm not as old as, well, Dave, as an example, right? Okay. So, right, that outward man is perishing day by day. And as that outward man is perishing, we have this interesting sort of dialogue that's going on inside. The old house is getting older, right? And there's no Bob Vila around to come renovate this old body of mine. That's not going to happen. Yet we are called, as it says in this passage, that through our inner nature is being renewed day by day. There's this juxtaposition. And that's normal for us to have this regular wearing down of the old body. It reminds us that there is an eternity out there because we are headed towards it. And in fact, if you look at Paul's life, you remember all the beatings that he took, right? The whippings, beat almost to death, stoning, all sorts of stuff like that. There's even in ministry advanced decay, right? If you're here, like the worship team meets, and they're here, instead of sleeping in or whatever it is, coming here early. I think about the trips that I've taken overseas to Cambodia, the number of hours that I've spent on an airplane with my knees all cramped up. There's lots of people here who are suffering and working hard for the ministry. Sometimes, like we fold these letters, and you know, Ray gets a paper cut on his tongue or whatever it is, right, for putting letters together for our ministry. Those sort of things happen, right? The ministry and the very work that Christ is calling us to do can help even accelerate the decay that we see. It's an extra emphasis that as the lifestyle that we lead in Christ picks up and speeds up, because the more mature we are, the more that we begin to participate in the ministries, the worse the decay actually gets, and the more that we're reminded of eternity, where we're headed. So we juxtapose that with the second part, that our inner nature is being renewed day by day. The soul of every believer, the inner man, is becoming a new creation day by day by day. We have this continual, regular growing and maturation that's going on inside of us. In fact, we're told that every 7 years, our bodies, all the cells within inside of them, or the vast majority of them, are being rotated. So in effect, even though the outside is dying and decaying, we're kind of getting a new shell like every 7 years. Isn't that interesting? But I still remember the way I looked 7 years ago and 14 years ago and 21 years ago and longer than that. And even though my body is being renewed over and over and over again, it's still decaying. So apparently not fast enough is it getting renewed. And my identity still, even though all the cells in my bodies have changed out at least once in their lifetime, I still have continuity of thought. I have continuity of spirit. And the same thing is true in terms of our eternal state, that while our old body is dying away, our inner spirit is being renewed day by day by day by day. That regardless of what happens to us externally, internally, we still have a continuity of spirit that is growing and growing and growing. The inner self continues to grow, and that is our goal, is to continue to grow in Christ's likeness. So, as we are decaying on the outside, we are advancing on the inside, believe it or not. We are decaying on the outside, which is pointing us to eternity. And as we are pointed to eternity by the very fact that we are falling apart on the outside, our inner side is being renewed over and over and over again. And why is it being renewed? To prepare us for eternity. Our external body reminds us that we're headed to eternity. The internal spirit is getting prepared for eternity. So on one hand, physical decay is a constant reminder, and then the other reminder that we have is that spiritual renewal is absolutely mandatory. In fact, Michelangelo said this, as the marble washes away from the sculpture, more and more the statue grows from within inside. And I really think that's what's happening to us as a Christian. Because as the physical body is decaying, even helped along and accelerated in ministry, the inner self continues to be exposed as that stature and that person that is the likeness of Jesus Christ. So the implication is we need to love getting older. We don't have to like the side effects of it, I suppose. But we need to love and enjoy getting older and growing older, not just from the external perspective, but from the internal perspective, being renewed on the inside. God has designed your life as a Christian so that as you get older on the outside, you get younger on the inside. As you get older on the outside, you get younger on the inside. You are more and more renewed each day. So my question to you this morning is, are you more nimble spiritually now than you were a year ago? Are you more nimble now? Just think about when you were younger, and physically, right? When I was young, I mean, I could bounce off of like anything. As you're getting older spiritually, being more and more nimble, are you more and more nimble spiritually? So when you see things on TV or you go to a museum and they talk about things being millions and billions of years old, are you able to quickly say, that doesn't square with what Scripture says? You're more nimble. Maybe you're faster, right? When I was younger, I was like a gazillion times more fast than I am now. It takes me like a half an hour to walk out to the car now, right? When I was a kid, I'd been back out to the car back and forth before I ever took a step, right? That's just the way it was when I was younger. Are you faster now than when you were younger? So temptation comes in. What's the first thought? Scripture pops to your brain. You're faster spiritually. Your spiritual acumen is through the roof, because as the temptations of life come in, as the weight of life comes in and you're weighed down, you react immediately. Your reactions are lightning fast. Are you more resilient spiritually now than you were in the past? You know, when I was a kid, I'd be bouncing off the walls. I think I was bruised all over the place. I'd be getting cuts and things like that. Boy, now I'd fall, I'd break my hip. I'd be laid up for a month. When I was a kid, I don't think you could destroy me. I think my bones, you know, they bent like a piece of plastic. When hard times come, are you more resilient? Do you feel younger inside spiritually than you ever have in the past? That's what we're being called into. That's how we learn to love God's love. The love that he has for us in renewal, because as we're renewed on the inside, we're learning day by day on how to accelerate our spiritual maturity. Point three in your outline. Savoring God's love and renewal allows us, or is needed to allow us, to focus on the deeper realities. And they kind of work hand in hand in this way, that as we savor the realities of eternity, it allows us to savor God's love deeper and more. Look at verse 17. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. For this slight momentary affliction. Well, and the indication there is it's slight and momentary in affliction. Don't those words kind of seem to be contradictory? Slight and affliction, right? Actually, if you look at the word, right, slight and momentary, you kind of get this idea of light, right? It's minor. But then you have this word that sits next to it, which is affliction, which is like a huge pressure. How do we square those things out? Well, from a human perspective, Paul's own testimony seems to indicate that even though he was beaten near death, that is a light affliction compared to eternity. It's bittersweet. On one end, it's really cruel to be beaten down. As we think of all the trials and temptations in our life, it's really cruel that we are beaten down on a regular basis. But as we compare that to eternity, it gives us hope and energy and encouragement to move forward. One theologian said it this way: a little joy enters into us while we are in the world. We shall enter into joy where it is there. A few drops here and there of joy is what we experience. But when we enter into eternity, a whole ocean is awaiting us. You see, while we have lots of affliction going on, the joy that we see right now is minimal. But as we focus and as our body reminds us about eternity and as we are being spiritually matured for eternity, we have an entire ocean of joy that's awaiting us. That's the eternal weight of glory that we read about here. The affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comprehension. An eternal weight. Well, this concept of weight actually is like a heavy mass. In fact, the idea is that if you had a scale and you put this mass on the scale, that the needle on the weight on the scale would just go right up to the top. Poof. It's the heaviest weight that the scale can have. It is, when we think of eternal glory, it is the maximum extent of glory that we can understand. And that thought, those ideas, meditating on the realities of the eternal weight of the glory of Jesus Christ in our lives will allow us to overshadow, to outscale any trouble that's within our lives. The afflictions viewed by themselves might seem so heavy, but when it compared to the eternal glory of God and of Jesus Christ that lays ahead, they are just light and tiny. It's preparing us. It's producing us. It's accomplishing in us something which we don't innately have or internally have. Afflictions produce glory, and glory is out of the proportion of the afflictions. The greater the trial, the greater the difficulty, the greater the issue in life, the more we appreciate where we are headed to eternity. You see it? Savor it. Love it. Love the afflictions that we see in life, because as we love them, we learn to love the glory of God even more. It compels us to think of eternity. We think of the bitter cup of life that we drink now, but how sweet the eternal fruit of a relationship with Jesus Christ will be. Life is very bitter right now, but in the end, when we think of the fruit that we'll experience with Jesus Christ, it will be so sweet. Look with me here at verse 18. And as we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen, for the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. The things that are which are seen and not seen. That kind of seems to be the balancing act here. Well, how do we get endurance to deal with, or nutrients in our lives to deal with the challenges that are there at a foot around us? Well, we need to look past the physical and point our lives to the spiritual. We need to be looking past what is temporary and focusing on things that are not perishable. This verse doesn't merely describe a human vision in terms of what are we actually seeing with our eyes. Rather, it's talking about what is most important to us. When we focus on those things that are temporal, that fall apart, our vision is limited. In fact, I think of like my prescription glasses that I have. I'm myopic. I can only see things that are close. If I take my glasses off, I can't see out there. I'm short-sighted. I can only see things that are near in front of me. And that's so often the way that we live when we live a fast food type of Christian lifestyle. We only focus on those things that are right around here. So as we think of the hardships and the trials and the sufferings that Paul talked about in the scriptures and that we encounter day by day and throughout our life, we get so wrapped up in the trials and the tribulations that we miss the main focus of life, which is not on those things that are transient and not on those things that are gratifying us in the short term and not on those things that Satan hands us out day by day. But rather we focus on those things that are eternal. The object of our ministry is not on what we see, but it's on what we don't see. It's on that reward that we will have when we pass into eternity. It's the reward that awaits us once we are at the judgment seat of Jesus Christ. A theologian once said it this way: to be able to see the earthly things requires sight. To be able to see eternal things requires insight. So sight for the visible things and insight for the invisible things. The first mode of vision is natural. The second mode of vision is spiritual. In earthly vision, our discernment is based on intellect. What do we naturally know in our heads or think? In spiritual vision, our discernment is based on faith, and it goes back to that faith and strength that we have in Jesus Christ. So to preserve us through the trials, we need to be renewed and loving Christ's eternal glory, because when we focus on that eternal glory and where we're going, that short-sightedness that's right in front of us, It fades away because our focus is far beyond ourselves. We need a change of perspective. You know, and I think about, again, some things that are around me in changing perspective. And so often when I come back from Cambodia, people ask, so what did you eat this time? You know, and lemongrass soup and frogs and bugs and rats and snakes and whatever else. And most people are like, ugh, none of that stuff sounds good. And let me change your perspective a little bit. When I come back from Cambodia, I feel horrible. It's after I started eating American food. I absolutely feel just ripped up inside. Believe it or not, eating things like bugs and snakes and grass soup and things like that is healthy. Because at least it's fresh, right? Think about it. I actually, this morning, I grabbed a box of cereal, and these were some of the things that were on there. These are things that my kids eat every day. High fructose corn syrup, absorbic acid, mixed taco folloras for freshness. Does that sound like freshness? If I can't pronounce it, that's not fresh. That's a chemical. No wonder we feel so sick when we come back. What we need is a different perspective. When you eat a frog, its ingredient is frog, right? It's 100% natural frog. There ain't anything else you need to add to it. It is what it is. When you eat American-style food, the reason it takes a while to get used to eating it is because, man, it's all full of stuff, right? The perspective needs to change. What's the good food? Most people look at the list of things that we eat in Cambodia and they say, that's not good food. It depends on your perspective. Our brothers in Cambodia, when they come over, they just are ripped up for weeks when they're over here because the food is really hard on you. When you're eating healthy, fresh every day, regardless of the type of meat that it is, if you can get by that, it's healthy and you feel wonderful. At least I do. We need to change that perspective. We need to savor the life that God has given us. So often we feel that our life is weighed down and we're too busy with distractions. We'd rather be people pleasers than God pleasers. And you know what? Your life might maybe not that bad, right? Consider the plate that which God has set in front of you and enjoy it. Savor it. Love it. We need a fresh outlook. We need entirely updated thinking to focus on the eternity of God. Completely new actions are needed because our very disposition is newer. We think of renewal, and what do we think of? Doing the same thing over and over and over again. You know, I think about books as an example of this. If you get a textbook, what do you get? You get, I don't know, version one of the book. And then if somebody gives you another book, oftentimes, especially at a university, maybe it's version two of the book. It's just simply the same book, just updated with a few more notes and commentaries and things like that. That is not the library that God wants for your life. He does not want a series of version one of the book and version two of the book and version three of the book. The library that God wants for your life is an entire array of books. He wants you to be renewed in your thinking of the books that need to be in your library. So rather than saying, I just want to talk about the next chapter or the next verse or the next part of this book, think of the entire library of books that God has set out in front of you that make up your life. You need to savor the library that God is setting out in front of you. When I was older, when I was younger, there were books that I read that were around. You know, so you start with children's books. See Jane Run, you know, very basic. Those were the types of books that I had when I was a child. Peter Pan, Dr. Seuss. It's all frivolity. When you're a little child, it works. And then as you get older, you move into a different set of books. And these also are the books of life that you need to start to savor. And I think of things that kind of parallel that. The Adventures of Tom Sawyer. As we're growing older and moving from frivolity to a little bit older life, right? We start to think of adventure. And then what happens with Tom Sawyer? He also gets into trouble. Right? Is that not like our teenage years? You think of the book Little Women, right? This whole book is about overcoming character. Meg had to overcome vanity, Joe a hot temper, Beth shyness, Amy selfishness. As our books in our library are added on and the stacks and the rows of books continue to increase, God is laying out a library that tells your entire life. Maybe your library sometimes gets a little confusing. You think of some of the things that have been in there. Douglas Adams wrote a book called Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. If you've ever read it, it's kind of a wacky book. They're looking for the ultimate questions in life. And you know what the answer is? Does anybody remember? 42. I mean, it's useless. Just a dumb answer for the ultimate answer for the questions of life. But yet, so often, especially in our younger years, we're focused on trying to answer those ultimate questions in life. And you know what we end up with? So long and thanks for all the fish. That's one of the key quotes for the book. Right? Our lives at a young age oftentimes are full of foolishness while we think of solving and looking for these life's bigger questions. And then oftentimes as we get a little bit older, we try other books. Sometimes we have a self-help book or a mystery book. And sometimes we get into horror stories that are within our life. Our lives are a regular Edgar Allan Poe sort of life. That's not what God wants, right? God wants you to have one book, all of your books stacked together, all stack up to one book on the end. It's the book of life, right? In Revelation 20:12, it says this, "Standing before the throne, all the books were open. And then another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books." We need to savor each book in our life that God has put in front of us. And we need to be in love as we work on the current book that God has right in front of us. We need to savor those books. We need to be not just renewed. We need to be new in essence and faith. Savor the faith that has brought you here. Savor the faith that strengthens you in Jesus Christ. We need to be new and renewing to love to grow old physically and to grow more vibrant spiritually. We need to savor becoming like Jesus Christ. And we need to be new when we encounter our life's difficulties and trials. Savor Christ's eternal glory. And as we savor Christ's eternal glory and as we love it, we will be able to deal with those difficulties and trials in life. We need to savor the current book of your life. God has a storyline that is building to a great climax. It's more than the next sentence, more than the next paragraph. There are volumes of books that are yet to be written in your life, and yet God is the author that is stacking them one right after the next, with the ultimate book being the book of life that will close it all out. And as we savor that reality in our lives, there is a good news and a good love that there's a single author that is in control of the storyline. You are a main character, and the plot of your life is well worthwhile. And it's not just that it's your life and your plot, but it's all of those characters that are commingled around your life that give it substance and depth. And because the author of life is penning this whole thing down with us, it gives us depth and richness and meaning. And as we savor and as we love that and as we participate in the plan of God, our life has texture and depth and greater joy than we would ever know. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord and Savior, we are thankful for this day. Lord, I thank you that you've given us a time today to spend going through your scriptures, Lord. I thank you that you've offered us eternal life, Lord, that for those of us who put our faith in you, that we are encouraged that someday our names will be written in the book of life, Lord. We look forward to that time, Lord. We savor and love you as we look at you as the eternal author of life, and at life's greatest challenges will be overcome because we know that you're writing the next chapter, the next book, and you will guide us through it. We don't have to skip ahead to the end, Lord. We know that you are in control of all things, the very plot of our lives, Lord. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.